Next, let's look at sedimentary rocks. Sedimentary rocks form in a much different manner than igneous rocks. No magma is involved. Rather, they are made from sediment. Sedimentary rocks form from the lithification of sediment. So first, what is sediment? Basically, sediment is simply little pieces of mineral material and organic material. Igneous rocks were made out of crystals. Sedimentary rocks are made out of pieces of stuff, more precisely, pieces of sediment. So sedimentary rocks are formed by the lithification of sediment. Well, what's lithification? Well, we've encountered the prefix lith before. It means rock. So lithification literally means rockification, but that's not very helpful. Lithification consists of two processes, compaction and cementation. So sedimentary rocks are either formed as sediment gets compacted together due to the weight of overlying sediment, or the sedimentary rocks can form by the sediment being cemented together, basically as minerals present in the groundwater precipitate around sand and gravel grains. Typically, only very, very small particles, mud and clay-sized particles, can be compacted together in order to form a rock. You kind of know that. You've taken mud in your hands and compressed it enough that it's stuck together. Well, that same process can happen at a much larger scale to form rocks. Larger particles are harder to get to stick together, so sands and gravels and those size particles generally need some sort of cementing agent like calcite or quartz or iron oxide, some mineral that crystallizes out of the groundwater onto the mineral grains and helps hold them together. Looking at this diagram, you can also imagine what's happening in our very own San Francisco Bay or out in the ocean beyond the Golden Gate. Water from the rivers, the Sacramento River and other rivers that come into the bay. Fast-moving water, as it enters into the bay, slows down. The water that's now at a slower velocity can't hold as much material. The fine particles, like the muds and clays, settle down to the bottom and over time get compacted and compacted until eventually that compacted mud turns into a sedimentary rock that we call shale. Interestingly, as shown here, sediments are often laid down in layers. So as a result, sedimentary rocks often have layers. Here in this picture, you can see the layers of some sedimentary rocks. These were originally laid down flat as well, but for some reason, they've been tilted. We'll talk more about what might cause that in the next couple weeks. Just as igneous rocks had subtypes, so too sedimentary rocks have subtypes. There's three subtypes of sedimentary rocks: detrital, also called clastic, chemical, and organic. In general, the subtypes refer to the material that the rock is composed of. In detrital or clastic rocks, they're literally made of pieces, which is what clast means. Pieces of mineral material like little pieces of sand, gravels, and muds. Chemical sedimentary rocks are made from crystals that have formed as water evaporated. And organic sedimentary rocks are formed from organic material like that of plants. Let's first look more carefully at the clastic or detrital sedimentary rocks. Detrital rocks are more common than the other two subtypes, so more common than the chemical or organic rocks, and they form in many different settings and result in distinctly different looking rocks. Some examples include sandstone, which is made from cemented sand particles. Where do you suppose sandstone forms? Well, where does sand accumulate? Sandstone forms in two general environments, beaches and deserts. Another detrital sedimentary rock is called a conglomerate. A conglomerate is made up of rounded gravels and sands that are cemented together. Where would this rock form? Where do you find rounded gravels and sands? Hopefully you said a river or a stream. Anywhere that there's fast-moving water that's fast enough to allow the rocks to tumble downstream and move and knock against each other is going to result in the rounding of those rocks and pebbles that then later gets cemented together to form the conglomerate. A third type of detrital sedimentary rock is shale. Shale is actually the most common sedimentary rock, and as we already discussed, it's made of compacted mud. So it forms where mud accumulates, like in bays and lakes and in the ocean, offshore, away from the wave zone. So these sedimentary rocks can tell us a lot about the geologic history of an area. Wherever you find a conglomerate, you know that it was once a river environment. If you find sandstone, you know that it was either a beach or a desert, and you need to look for further clues in the rock to figure out which. If you find shale, you know it was probably an ocean or a bay, or if it's much smaller in scale, perhaps a lake. Chemical sedimentary rocks form in a much different manner. Classically, they form as water evaporates, leaving all the minerals that were dissolved in the water behind. So chemical sedimentary rocks form as minerals crystallize out of water as it evaporates. Your book also lumps in another subset of rocks that form when ocean critters, shelled organisms, take minerals out of the water to incorporate it into their hard parts. When these macroscopic and microscopic organisms die and they fall to the ocean floor, they accumulate as sediment there as well, and they can form kind of biochemical sedimentary rocks in the bottoms of the ocean. For now, let's just focus on the chemical sedimentary rocks that form as water evaporates. You can imagine as ocean water evaporates, salt is left behind. So rock salt is one common sedimentary, chemical sedimentary rock. Rock gypsum as well. And both of these minerals are mined from shallow arid bays where salt water is evaporating. This is a picture that was in my geology textbook showing salt production right here locally in the southern part of the San Francisco Bay. So these rocks form in shallow arid bays. They can also form in arid areas like in Utah around the Great Salt Lake, so salt flats and that sort of area. Limestone is a chemical sedimentary rock that forms from shelled organisms. Those shelled organisms take up water, ocean water, into their bodies and crystallize out the minerals that they need to make their hard parts. In this case, the mineral is called calcite. And then when those shelled organisms die and get buried in the muck in the bottom of the ocean, they form into chemical sedimentary rocks called limestone. Here's a close-up of a limestone rock where you can actually still see shell fragments. That's not always possible. And here's a place where this rock is found now. You can see that the once flat-lying sedimentary layers have been tipped up on their edge. We'll describe why that might occur next week, because generally sedimentary layers are laid down flat. And also, this is now on the Olympic Peninsula. Clearly, this is no longer an ocean environment, but the rocks tell us that when it formed, it was an oceanic environment. It's just a lot of uplift and movement of this rock has occurred since then. Our third subtype of sedimentary rocks is organic sedimentary rocks. And these rocks form as plant material is buried and compacted over millions of years. The classic organic sedimentary rock is coal, which forms when vegetative material gets buried in muck or water in some environment where there's not a lot of oxygen present. If plant material just dies and is decaying on the surface of the earth, there's plenty of oxygen there and bacteria will decompose the material. But if it gets buried in muck, like it would in a tropical swamp, it simply gets compacted and over time forms a rock called lignite coal, and then subbituminous coal and bituminous coal, etc. This picture here shows a few coal veins and some other sedimentary rocks that are being mined here in the United States. Interestingly, the United States has the largest coal reserves in the world, which might seem strange because I just got done saying that coal forms in tropical swampy areas. And the last time I checked, the United States was not a tropical swampland. Well, it's not now. 250 million years ago or so, what is now North America lied very much right over the equator. And what is now North America would have had a lot of tropical swampy lands, kind of like what the jungles of Brazil or the Congo would look like today. So the coal deposits we are using now in the United States are a result of the fact that North America used to be in a much different place. It used to be over the equator 250 million years ago. You should be able to note the three subtypes of sedimentary rocks and how they form. And further, you should be able to list a few examples of each subtype and note in more specific terms where those rocks would form. This graph here shows the most common sedimentary rocks, and you can see that shale is the most common sedimentary rock, followed by sandstone and limestone. So how do we identify sedimentary rocks? Well, first of all, we need to figure out if it is a sedimentary rock, and we do that by looking what it's composed of. Generally, sedimentary rocks are made out of pieces of stuff. Detrital sedimentary rocks are made out of pieces of sediment. Organic sedimentary rocks are made out of altered plant material. And chemical sedimentary rocks are made up of pieces of shells or perhaps crystals. The crystalline sedimentary rocks, though, are quite different than the igneous rocks that we looked at earlier because they're made out of different minerals. It's a bit beyond the scope of our class to identify sedimentary rocks, but this is how it would be done. If you thought you had a sedimentary rock, first you determine if it's made mainly of mineral material, pieces of sands, gravels, and sands, and you'd use this chart here to identify the rock. Or if you thought it was chemical or organic, you would use this chart over here, and you'd start by trying to figure out what mineral it was made out of, and that would go a long way to telling you what rock you have. Sedimentary rocks are very important to geographers because they give us a detailed geologic history of the area. Each sedimentary rock forms in a different environment. For example, if coal is present, we know the environment used to be a tropical and swampy environment. If a sandstone is present, we can surmise that it must have been an ocean or a beach, or a desert. If we find shale, it was probably an ocean or a bay. If we find a conglomerate, it's a river environment, etc. Notably, a huge area in the middle of the United States, from Minnesota to Oklahoma, is made up of layers of sandstone, shale, and limestone. It's certainly not an ocean environment now, but we know that the rocks tell us that there once existed a huge inland sea in this area. Similarly, look here at the rocks of the Grand Canyon. Notice all the layers, which of course are very typical for sedimentary rock. The very steep cliff-like areas are limestone or sandstone. So limestone is probably a deeper ocean, and sandstone is either a beach or a desert. The gradual slopes here are likely shale, which is a different type of ocean environment, or it could be a bay. So we can see that the Grand Canyon has not always been the desert landscape that exists today. Indeed, through much of the Grand Canyon's history, there's been receding and advancing seas, and we see that history in the rock record. Lastly, pause the video and make sure that you can answer these questions on sedimentary rocks.